The next item on the order paper is a motion on legacy inquests. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. As two amendments have been selected and are published on the Marshall list, an additional 15 minutes has been added to the total time. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. The proposer of each amendment will have 10 minutes to propose and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Before we begin, the House should note that the amendments are mutually exclusive. So if amendment number 1 is made, the question will not be put on amendment number 2. And I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly endorses the 5-year plan advanced by the Lord Chief Justice in consultation with victims' families to deal with the backlog in legacy inquests, and calls on the British Government, in recognition of its obligations under Article 2 of the European Convention on Human Rights, to provide the funding required.
Declan Kearney to move the motion. Éirim Declan Kearney.
Members, yesterday we had a very temperate debate and agreed a motion on addressing the past. I hope we can achieve a similar consensus with this motion this afternoon. It has been drafted to try and achieve that objective. The amendments, unfortunately, tabled distract from achieving the desired and required consensus. In October 2015, the Assembly debated a Sinn Féin motion which called for our coronial court system to be resourced to function in a timely and effective way and to address outstanding legacy inquests. There was agreement during that debate that victims' families deserve the support of our local political institutions in having access to the necessary coronial mechanisms, properly resourced legacy inquests being absolutely key to that. In the previous 10 years, only 13 legacy inquests have been heard. Later on, in November 2015, the Fresh Start Agreement approved a framework to deal with the past, including addressing the issue of legacy inquests. The Fresh Start Agreement created the potential for victims to effectively pursue truth, recovery and justice for their relatives. It opened the door, importantly, of hope for victims' families. However, during those negotiations, the British Government withdrew the political commitment that it made the previous year in 2014 to ensure that there would in fact be maximum information disclosure to families. It insisted on having a national security veto and it refused to draft the appropriate enabling legislation. Now, that's the reason, Deputy Speaker, for the current impasse on legacy issues. And that is directly, unfortunately, attributable to the negative influence of the Ministry of Defence and the security services over this British Government's policy. And the effect of all of that has been to compound families' disappointment and anger. And the impact of this veto and the associated impasse affects all sections of our community, nationalist and unionist. Over one year, since that October 2015 debate and since the Fresh Start Agreement, victims' families are still being failed, and for no good reason. So Sinn Féin submitted proposals on how to address and end this impasse, but the British Government should answer publicly now why it rejects that template. National security is a smokescreen. There is no arguable way in which disclosure of information about the actions of state forces or agents 20, 30 or 40 years ago could in any way undermine British national security in the present day's geopolitical context. I hope today a similar consensus could emerge from this debate in support of the Lord Chief Justice's plan to deal with the backlog of legacy inquests and in calling on the British Government to recognise its obligations and to release the required funding. Victims currently have no other option other than to pursue the truth individually through the courts. The only Article 2 compliant mechanism which exists in the North and is available to them is the legacy inquest. And there are now 56 legacy cases relating to 97 deaths representing citizens from both nationalist and unionist backgrounds, including groups such as the Ballymurphy Massacre families and the Kelly's Bar families. Now, last February, the Lord Chief Justice proposed to fast-track these cases, which date back 45 years, back to 1971. And he believes that that could be completed in 5 years with PSNI and MOD cooperation and with the necessary funding being released. And the Lord Chief Justice has requested £25 million in immediate funding, which he has suggested could come from the £150 million politically committed by the British Government in 2014 to address dealing with the past. The British Government, however, is now blocking this approach by refusing to release those funds. And it is using, not at the moment, I've a lot to say, but if I have time, I'll see you, I'll talk to you later, okay? It is using the DUP refusal to discuss the proposal at the executive as a bogus excuse for doing so. That stance adopted by the British Government is an absolute disgrace because, you see, regardless to political disagreements within this chamber and this assembly or disagreements in the executive, the British Government has an international obligation to ensure timely and effective investigations into legacy issues are compliant with Article 2 of the European Convention. And that's not an optional extra. I charge that after 45 years, it is well past time for the British Government to ensure that the coronial system here is capable of satisfying its Article 2 obligations. As the Lord Chief Justice reminded us in September, the pressing need to make progress was recognised by the Committee of Ministers of the Council of Europe. Its last report said that it was essential for the British Government to take all necessary measures to ensure the legacy system here is properly resourced and staffed to enable investigations to be completed. Now, the Lord Chief Justice has engaged extensively in relation to his proposals. Experts like Niels Musniecks, the Council of Europe Commissioner on Human Rights, and Pablo de Grief, the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights, have advised on the principles which should underpin compliant Article 2 compliant legacy inquests here. And the Lord Chief Justice, importantly, has also engaged with victims' families. And his approach has helped to restore a level of confidence in our justice system here in the North. And to paraphrase Sammy Douglas yesterday, the Lord Chief Justice's proposals actually help to restore, not to defer, hope. He has found a solution to this crisis facing our coronial system and the lack of available legacy inquests. This motion seeks cross-party endorsement of the Lord Chief Justice's plan and for the British Government to comply with its Article 2 obligations. The effective blocking of the Lord Chief Justice's proposals by the Government is wrong, quite simply wrong. It constitutes a malign political interference in developing a resourced and Article 2 compliant coronial system here. And that's why more than 30 families from both nationalist and unionist backgrounds are now taking legal action against the British Government's refusal to meet its human rights obligations. It is offensive, members, to human and democratic rights that these families have to go to court to secure access to legacy inquests. And I can think of no other democratic society where that would have to happen. That shocking reality ought to concentrate the collective minds of this Assembly today. And we should show cross-party political leadership on this issue. Members, today's debate should avoid the temptation to indulge in point scoring, political recrimination and whataboutery. Because for the naysayers at the other end of the chamber, the reality is that the blame game is a dead-end street, in case you didn't know. And we all know we don't agree on the past. And we've rehearsed our multiple narratives, and you have your narratives also, many times before. But I believe that we owe it to the families being denied legacy inquests to show that there is the potential for resolution of these issues which can transcend political differences. Because as more time passes, family members are beginning to die. Important witness evidence is being lost. Another generation is being denied closure, and that, members, is not a laughing matter. The Lord Chief Justice's proposals are a roadmap to find that solution. A failure to agree is to fail the families once again. I believe we should unite in bringing pressure to bear upon the British Government to release these funds and to meet its obligations. And yes, that will test the commitment of the state and its agencies to deal with the past. But that's not what this motion is about. This is about information, recovery and justice. It's about speaking truth to power. Legacy inquests should be treated, as the families have told me, legacy inquests should be treated as a free-standing issue. This is about restoring confidence in the justice system here in the North. And, Principal Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, I want to quote directly from some of the words of Lord Chief Justice Declan Morgan. We need to deal effectively with our past. We cannot do that if we leave any section of our society behind. We cannot move on while we remain under the shadow of the past, nor should we. But time is not on our side. As I have already said, time is not on the side of victims' families. Movement on legacy inquests is urgently required. That's what the families deserve. That is what we collectively should deliver.
I call Doug Beattie to move amendment number one.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. It's interesting, I'm sitting across the room from Mr Kearney, and at one time we would have been physical enemies. Now we're probably just political adversaries, and the only thing that we change is, if are against each other, is probably insults, which is thorns out better than bullets. I am absolutely clear that you are passionate about getting justice for those people who you represent, and all people in Northern Ireland. And I hope you can look at me and see me as that I'm exactly the same, that I want to get justice as well. Because we've been able to move on, but a lot of the victims out there, many, many victims out there, not just those who are looking for a legacy inquest, but many victims out there haven't been able to move on and haven't been given justice. But it is an important debate, and I acknowledge that it's an important debate. The problem that we have is we have politically entrenched positions here in Northern Ireland, where our views are indetractable. You're looking at it at one narrative, and you've explained that, and possibly I'm looking at it from a different narrative, and that's creating issues. And certainly, sorry, where was that from? Oh, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, absolutely.
Cormac, I'd appreciate you giving way. Just to say, I don't think that giving justice to one family or one set of families or one set of victims removes the opportunity to allow other victims to get justice also. This debate is not about getting justice for one so that nobody else can get it. This debate is about just dealing with this particular issue, and I think that's something that needs to be addressed in this chamber. We're not talking about justice for one against another. It's justice for everybody.
Can I ask all members to make their comments through the chair?
You know, I can't disagree with that. I'm not going to disagree with that. You're absolutely right. It's justice for everybody. You know, if it's not justice for everybody, what's the point? You know, so we need justice for everybody. But listen, you know, I'll go through this if I can, please, because there does need to be clarity, and there does need to be a little bit of lateral thinking here if we're going to get away from these indetractable positions that we are in, because we are going to lead victims down a cul-de-sac here, and I'm fearful of leading them down a cul-de-sac once again. Some will think that the issue is just the state not giving up information because they say they can't give it because of national security. Well, in some cases, they're absolutely right. If they're going to give information which is going to cause the death of an individual, and we've seen that previously, or it is an issue of national security, then they shouldn't give that information. But if it's just because to save their blushes and embarrassment, then they should give that information. I think everybody is accountable. I think soldiers are accountable for their actions in Northern Ireland. If they go outside the law, they should be held to account, as I do with paramilitaries, as I do with terrorists. And I think I've said that on many, many occasions. But there are mechanisms out there which helps release that information to help with some of these inquiries. Some will say that the stumbling block is purely that the Westminster government will not release the funding for the legacy inquiries. But I sat with the,
the families, the Ballymurphy families, and I listened to their testimony, and it was a harrowing testimony, I've got to say. And I did not feel comfortable when I left the room having heard it, but it was important to hear it. But they asked the Secretary of State a very clear question: will you release the money? And he said, if the executive asks me for the money, I will release it. That's what he said, and he said it on three occasions. So seriously, and this helps because it brings clarity, let the executive make a statement as to where the issue lies within the executive, that they're not asking for the money. If somebody is blocking it, If somebody is blocking it, then bring it out so we all understand what the issue is, because I think I know what the issue is, and in this, in many ways, I probably sit with the DUP, and that is the stumbling block is equality and parity, a system that is balanced, fair, impartial and appropriate for everybody. And I think a lot of people see the legacy inquiry as giving a leg up to one group while pushing the other group to the side. Now, that might be a perspective, I know that, but I'm telling you, out in society, that's what people are seeing. To be Article 2 compliant doesn't mean you have to have a legacy inquest. It says you have to have an independent investigation or inquiry. That's what it states. That's what you need. And especially if a state actor has been involved. A state actor has been involved. State actors are pretty much involved in every death over the Troubles. July 1983, four UDR soldiers were killed when their unarmoured vehicle went over a mine. The state failed to protect them. Why are they not on the legacy list? Shankill bombing. There is thoughts that Stakenice was involved in that. A UK human intelligence source. State involvement. Why are they not on the list of legacy inquiries? We could probably say that for an awful lot. So this is why I'm trying to say we need to have lateral thinking in how we're going to get around this, because we are entrenched. We're entrenched in our position that everybody should get an equal shout at this. And others are saying, no, let's get these legacy inquests up and running because the state were involved and it owes them. And I can see both sides of the argument here. Our judiciary is impartial. It's independent. We need to respect that, and I hope we all do respect that. And I think that we, and it's important that people understand it, that it is us, our executive, our assembly, it is up to us to find a way. And nothing stops us by bringing out a bespoke way of dealing with these particular issues. The Historical Investigations Unit can be independent within the confines of it. We can use that to give everybody the same thing. I think that's incredibly important. When we talk about the Lord Chief Justice five-year plan, and I said this before and I'll say this again, I respect our justice system, I respect our judges, and I respect their independence. But what is the five-year plan? I haven't seen a five-year plan. I've seen a statement, I've seen some paper articles, but I haven't seen a plan. I haven't seen a plan that lays out how he's going to deliver these inquests in 5 years. And that's fundamental to the motion you bring before, that this Assembly endorses the five-year plan that we haven't seen. Hasn't been published. Is the plan predicated on the assumption that inquest reform is the only option? Does the plan propose only non-jury inquests? What about requests for juries? What about multiple case hearings? Will the inquest hear all of the Ballymurphy families at the same time or individually? We don't know because we don't know the plan. We haven't seen the plan. What about witness protection? What about if somebody's called to one of these legacy inquests and he's infirm and he sees a doctor and a doctor says he can't come? Will there be a judicial review? Will that stretch things out? Can we get this in the 5 years? I think the point I'm making here is I really have not seen and do not understand the details of the Lord Chief Justice's five-year plan. So we're debating something we haven't actually seen or had been brought before us. I'll go back to the very start, if I may. And say that I do want justice, and I do want justice for all. and I do not think that anybody should be able to avoid justice. This isn't arguing for arguing's sake. This isn't countering a motion with amendment just for the sake of it. But as passionate as Mr. Kearney is about his motion and the people he's dealing with, then I'm the same as are other people. And I think that's important. So we do need, as an executive, as an assembly, to have lateral thinking and come up with something that works for all and not just for some. And I think that's key. So therefore, I move my amendment and I unfortunately cannot support your motion.
Éireann Sir Alex Atwood on Lasu Ado Bogu. I call Alec Atwood for Amendment 2 to be moved.
Thank you very much. Could I start where we should start and end, and that is with the victims and survivors who have over many, many years campaigned and are now within touching distance on one level of having a proper inquest into instance of the past. Whenever I meet any families that are dealing with their pain or heading towards an inquest, and be that the Shankill families, be it the Ballymurphy families, be it members of our own party who were victims of killings in the murder triangle in previous years, I always remember the words of an ancient Greek who said that in our sleep, pain that cannot forget falls drop by drop upon our heart, and in our own time, against our will, comes wisdom through the awful grace of God. And if there is any people and families in Northern Ireland that give expression to that wisdom, it's the families who have been campaigning around inquests and around truth and accountability and have been relentless in so doing. And I hope that wherever we divide on this, we always remember that. We'll not be supporting the Ulster Unionist Amendment because it removes the critical point that this matter now falls to the British Government to resolve, and they should resolve it now. But I must say to Sinn Féin that I would ask them, and I'd ask Gerry Kelly in particular, to reconsider not supporting our amendment, because our amendment is the words of the Lord Chief Justice. It's not my words or the SDLP words. They are the words of the Lord Chief Justice when the Lord Chief Justice said earlier this year that he called upon the local executive, the legislature and the British government should, as a matter of urgency, play their part in the release of monies. His words, not my words. And therefore, by relying upon his judgment and all that he said in relation to managing this issue, then that should be a matter that should be supported rather than something that should be rejected. And I would ask, for that matter to be considered by Sinn Féin between now and the end of this debate. What is this debate about? It is about two governments refusing to live up to the requirements of the rule of law, the needs for truth, and international standards. And the failure in the executive here is with the DUP, because it's the DUP who are blocking Mr. Beattie. It's the DUP who are blocking this matter, processing through the executive. It's not Sinn Féin. It is not the Justice Minister. It is the DUP. And that is a failure to listen to the directions of the Lord Chief Justice, and it's a failure to live up to the rule of law and international standards. But I don't think we'll convince the DUP to change their mind, because I'm sure the Justice Minister and Sinn Féin have tried mightily to do so. And in the absence of one government, because of the veto of the DUP, failing to live up to the requirements set by the Lord Chief Justice, then it falls to the London government to live up to the requirements, which is what the Lord Chief Justice said in his statement earlier this year, that he called upon the London government to fulfil their responsibilities as a matter of urgency. And the fact that the British government has not, and the fact that the Secretary of State meets victims and survivors and then denies them, and all of us, including Mr Beattie, and I want to acknowledge that Mr Beattie was at that meeting, when the Ballymurphy families met with the Secretary of State, and when he made it very clear he wasn't listening to them, they made it very clear that they weren't going to listen to him any further, and we all walked out. He meets, and then he does not listen. And then he does not live up to his responsibilities under international law and as the British government to release monies in relation to this matter. And he should hang his head in shame that on one hand he invites victims in to meet him, and on the other hand he then does not heed what they request. So we say to the British Secretary of State, do not deny the families, do not deny the Lord Chief Justice, and do not deny international requirements. Because if that's what you do in respect of funding of inquests in Northern Ireland now, then what are you planning when it comes to what might be an imminent public phase in respect of the consultation on legacy proposals? Are you again going to have a consultation on legacy proposals that deny families, deny the rule of law, deny international standards? Because that's the message that you're sending out by refusing to take up the challenge of the Lord Chief Justice in the failure of the DUP to release a request for money, to release monies to the inquest. SDLP have met the Secretary of State in relation to this matter, and we told him very bluntly, if you give a veto to a party in Northern Ireland on this, then you give a veto to other parties on other matters. And we know from a history that you do not go down that road. The issue of inquests, of course, Madam Deputy Speaker, is actually a touchstone of three fundamental other issues in relation to dealing with legacy. The first is the Lord Chief Justice has made clear that he needs multiple millions of pounds in order to take forward his legacy work. Mr Beattie has left, but the Lord Chief Justice, the High Court, through Lord Justice Kerr, called in barristers and solicitors representing families and the state and interrogated them in terms of what was happening in respect of inquests. Lord Chief Justice isn't making this up as he went along. He had formal hearings through Lord Justice Kerr, and then he had meetings with the families, separate meetings with the families, in order to outline what his programme of work might be. But he's indicated that he needs multiple millions of pounds. And since the British government said that they would give money in respect of legacy, not only has that request come in, but the steak knife monies request has come in, which is £35 million for up to seven years, and so on and so forth. So the British government, in dealing with this matter on inquests, need also to deal with the issue not just of money for inquests, but money for everything to deal with legacy. Because the budget required to deal with that has escalated over the last number of years beyond what it was even in Stormont House. Because if on the far side of this, the Lord Chief Justice is saying, I'm not getting the multiple millions of pounds to do my work, and the Chief Constable is not getting the money to do steak knife, and the rest of us are not getting the money to do all the legacy proposals, then we will let down victims and survivors even more than we have in the past. So if the Secretary of State recognises his error and the fundamental offence that he's causing in respect of not dealing with the issue of inquests now, when he deals with it, if he ever deals with it, if he ever stands up to the DUP veto, then he must deal with the issue of money. The second relevant issue in respect of inquests is one that was touched upon, well, not actually touched upon, spoken at length by Mr Kearney. Well, the issue of inquests is much more than the issue of disclosure. And the issue of legacy is much more than the issue of disclosure, important and central though it is. But the experience around inquests has been the resistance of the state to provide the information in good time and in full, and that it can then be shared as fully as possible with other people. That's the experience of inquests. And the Lord Chief Justice was trying to navigate through that in a way that actually got it into a better place. But if on the far side of this, that is the approach of state authorities to the issue of disclosure, or if that is the approach of those who are in command and control of any organisation, state or paramilitary, during the years of conflict, if anybody in command and control approach disclosure about their role and their orders in respect of anything that happened around murder and atrocity in Northern Ireland, be it the state or the government or its agencies, or be it the paramilitaries or those who are in command and control, then we will let down victims and survivors again. And if the issue of inquest is dealt with, let the issue of disclosure be dealt with. Otherwise, we are just selling something to people that they will see through on day one, and their hurt will be compounded. And the third issue is, and this is a reflection upon the families, if we don't support the families through all the legacy mechanisms, the History Archive, the HIU, the ICAI and ICIR, the IRG and the inquests, support them with money and advice and assistance and representatives, then they will not believe that the process is wholesome and worthwhile. And let that issue also be dealt with if the Secretary of State ever gets round to making the right call on this issue.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Principal, or Principal Deputy Speaker. I always get that mixed up. Thank you very much. I raise, I will say that we will not be supporting the motion, and we will not be supporting any of the amendments, although I would place on record sincere gratitude for the way that most members here to date and so far have spoken on this very sensitive issue. And I would also commend Doug Beattie for what he talked about with regards equality. He gave me a compliment earlier, so I'm going to have to return that, that favour, of course. But what Doug Beattie has said here today in this chamber is very close to our position. People throughout the ages have fought and campaigned on equality. Is it not just as important to fight for the victims and survivors to ensure that they have equality in making sure justice is served? Now, nowhere in that statement does it say one set of victims should be left behind or treated differently from another set of victims. And that's the crux, because see when you do, see when something or some system or some government or some department or some judicial system leaves victims behind or puts other victims at a higher level, there is more hurt, there is more pain placed on those victims. I have worked throughout the years with some of the family members of the T-Ban victims. Horrendous. I remember the day well. I was in the development where one of the victims lived. I seen the police cars going up first to speak to his wife. I was only out in the pavement in a parked car when it all happened. Quickly realised the atrocity had taken place, and quickly realised then too that I had lost someone who I grew up with, a friend. But I've been working with those family members ever since, or especially, I suppose, when I became involved in politics. And you can rest assured, when there is some sort of outcome or some completion of something, and then the victim and survivor of that atrocity, whatever it may be, comes forward and there's a briefing and someone says, well, we're not satisfied. We're still not satisfied, or we're still not this, or we're still not, we've got this and we've had this and we're still not satisfied. That puts a dagger into the hearts of those victims even further. And those victims feel forgotten even more so. And whilst I'm saying that every single victim that was involved in the Troubles, every single survivor who got caught up in that Troubles, in the Troubles, they need to go forward. But how do we pick and choose? Now, I know the legacy inquests are a special caption, and there's an onus on the government, and on both governments, in fact, with regards to this issue. And I would like to see them moving forward. But look what money we have, look what resource we have, 150 million. It's a fair bet to say that for 56 cases, Would 150 million look at it? I don't know. Does anyone know in this House? Yes, sir.
Cameron, and I agree with a lot of what he says about victims, because any victim has to have our sympathy here. But what we are talking about here, and I know his party and himself talks a lot about judicial processes, will he accept that the inquests that we're talking about are judicial process? So they are unlike, and I think you've said a moment ago that they're a different situation, that some of the families and some of the relatives are actually in the chamber today have been waiting some 45 years for this. In a judicial process, this is not something that had to be searched for, but something that existed and has been held up. So does the member, is the member arguing that that should be held up on the basis of other victims? And I have the sympathy, as with him, for all the victims in this case.
And the member has an extra...
Thank you. No, I'm not saying that it should be held up. I'm saying that the legacy inquest should continue. Now, we've had, what, three completed this year. Lord Chief Justice says he'd be completing two the next year. If I was to ask the Justice Minister today, and I asked the previous Justice Minister this in the Justice Committee, I asked the previous Justice Minister, are you sure, Minister, that all the muscle and sinew of your department and the police force is going in to tackle paramilitarism or crime? And the Minister said, and I can remember it well, he says, well, you have to be careful how you answer that, because resource is limited. And that's the crux. This all comes down, a lot of this comes down to cost also. So you have to make sure you treat people fairly, you treat people equally. And let's hear what the Lord Chief Justice says. And I'm quoting from him, it is impossible to see how the issue of legacy can be moved forward politically without progress having been made on the new legislation and in the absence of a clear assessment of the costs involved in implementing all of the elements of the legacy package. It is important that we move forward together in agreement to make sure we serve all victims.
I call David Ford.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. Today just shows how we can all show our concerns about the victims of the past with three somewhat different approaches being adopted. The Sinn Féin motion endorses the Lord Chief Justice's plans for inquests and then calls on the British Government to provide funding for them, saying nothing at all about executive responsibilities. The Ulster Unionist amendment only notes the LCJ's plans, although in proposing the amendment, Doug Beattie seemed to think he didn't actually know what he was noting, and calls on the executive to produce a balanced plan to move forward in all the areas of dealing with the legacy of the past. And the SDLP amendment endorses the Lord Chief Justice's plans and notes the failure of the executive to deliver so far, whilst also putting responsibility on the British government to deliver. It's absolutely clear from what's already been said, the failure of the executive to live up to its responsibilities and to deliver, as the memory of Stormont House agreement of 2 years ago, the memory of the so-called fresh start of a year ago fades, that we are still doing nothing to meet the needs of the victims. When the Lord Chief Justice made his speech at the beginning of September to start the legal term, it was extremely significant what he said. And I think some people didn't actually notice because of the measured language which he uses as a judge. The significance of the criticism that he made of the executive for their failure to deliver. Because it's now a year since he was given responsibility for the coroner's courts, since he, Lord Justice Weir, and a number of other judges, it was Lord Justice Weir, Mr. Atwood, not Lord Justice Kerr. You've downgraded Brian Kerr, but we'll not worry about that. It was absolutely clear the work that was being done, which dealt with reviewing the possibilities of progress in all the outstanding inquests. And a lot of good work has been done by the judiciary, a number of other judges who've taken responsibility for inquests, by the Courts and Tribunal Service, by policy staff within the DOJ to move things forward. And all of that has been let down by the failure of the executive to agree any way forward. The First Minister and the Deputy First Minister had a paper from me as Minister of Justice before the election, which they wouldn't table to the executive. They then wouldn't enable me to take an urgent decision. And it's absolutely clear from what emerged during the election campaign that the First Minister is the person who is exercising the veto. The British government may or may not be hiding behind that, but it's absolute nonsense to suggest that the veto at this stage lies anywhere other than with the First Minister. And Mr. Kearney's rant was perhaps inevitable coming from a Sinn Féin spokesman blaming everything on the British government, but maybe we should let him into a secret. In April of 2010, justice was devolved to this Assembly. It's a Minister of Justice and the Executive in Northern Ireland who bear responsibility moving things forward. The funding, yes, is supposed to be coming from the Treasury, but the rant that was directed against the British government and what they should be doing rather suggests that Mr Kearney and possibly other members of Sinn Féin don't actually believe in the devolution of justice at all. Now, we all know that there's a non-aggression pact in this chamber and indeed in other places between Sinn Féin and the DUP, but they are really carrying it to some extreme for either party to suggest that the fault lies anywhere than the blockage being put in by the DUP at the present time. Because if the First Minister had not blocked progress on the initial package to start the inquest process, then we could have seen something delivered for some families. We could have started the progress underway. Indeed, the DUP could have then looked back at Sinn Féin and say, we've delivered something, now you start delivering on your side as well. But by digging your heels in, the First Minister has actually guaranteed nothing at all will happen. And Mr Frew may talk about the costs and how far 150 million would go, but the DOJ knew at the time of Fresh Start that 150 million would not be adequate for all that was needed for legacy. But as long as the executive fails to take any steps whatsoever, they have no prospect of getting any more money released from the Treasury. We certainly need to see initially the action from the executive, and at that point money may be forthcoming from the Treasury. But unless we have something rational being done here, we will not actually get the opportunity to ask the Treasury to pay what they should be paying. I can understand points made by the Ulster Unionists about the issue of the hierarchy of victims, but there are at the moment people whose inquests could be proceeding if the money was released who are being let down by the system because of the failure to agree that money, and that's where it is simply not realistic to blame others. So the clear point is, if we are going to recognise responsibilities, we must ensure that both executive and then subsequently the UK government act, and they must move on
I
it now.
Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise to speak on this motion today, and as with yesterday's motion on addressing the past, we must recognise the importance of legacy inquests in helping Northern Ireland to progress. It's a massive issue that continues to prevent us from moving forward, and one which must be addressed and dealt with in a respectful and an impartial manner. For me, it is clear that the structures in place are the stumbling block which is holding up many of the processes. I believe that there is a political will to resolve this issue, but that the current system has been caught up in dealing with incredibly complex and sensitive cases involving vast amounts of information. There is also a very clear judicial will to move forward by the Lord Chief Justice, Sir Declan Morgan, and I would like to acknowledge the work he and his staff have already done in order to progress matters. Given the current difficulties surrounding legal aid, I feel that we are using a disproportionate amount of money looking at state-related cases rather than using the money for day-to-day policing. This focus has also led to families and survivors of non-state-related cases feeling ignored and excluded from the process. And we need a resolution for all of the victims. As I mentioned yesterday, the pain and suffering of those who have lost loved ones is not something that can be quantified or measured. It is therefore equally important that everyone, regardless of the circumstances, is dealt with on an equal footing. No one's family suffering is greater than another's. As we're all acutely aware, how we deal with our past is a matter on which we have squared the circle in 18 years since the signing of the Good Friday Agreement. We must reach agreement on how best to address legacy inquests and deal with the huge backlog of cases to allow victims and survivors to move on. The Lord Chief Justice's five-year plan focuses around the establishment of a dedicated legacy inquest unit overseen by Mr Justice Colton. All cases would be reviewed and managed before being transferred to the coroner for hearing. As presiding coroner, Justice Colton will see all related material in an unredacted format and will work to ensure that the inquest victims remain centred. Under the current system, only 13 legacy cases have been delivered in the last 10 years, and this is a situation which cannot continue and is completely impractical if we are ever to move on. It is clear that in order to progress towards resolution, that greater financial means must be allocated to engage both the human and technological resources required to competently complete the work. Addressing legacy inquests is something which is key to moving forward. However, without the additional funding, we may not be able to carry out these in an appropriate timescale. We cannot continue to fail victims and prolong the pain through not coming to a satisfactory conclusion. I am aware that Justice Minister is equally frustrated by the current situation and is keen to advance the Lord Chief Justice's five-year plan, and appreciate that she has met with the Secretary of State to discuss. I am also aware that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister have had in-depth and ongoing discussions with the UK Government, and I trust that these will continue in order to secure the necessary funding to bring these outstanding legacy inquests to a close. In closing, Principal Deputy Speaker, the need to provide independent, impartial and inclusive legacy inquests is indisputable. I fully appreciate that there is much more to dealing with the past and legacy inquests than there is time to go into today, but for the victims and survivors of Northern Ireland's past, I cannot stress enough the need to bring these matters to a close. I believe the Secretary of State is committed to seeing this happen, and whilst it will be a process which may take a number of years, at least for the victims, an assurance that an inquest for their loved one is imminent may be a step in the right direction. The finances required to take this forward is urgently required, and I trust that the discussions between the Secretary of State, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister will be positive, and we can finally see these inquests begin to move forward. Thank you.
Éireann Sir Michaela Boyle. I call Michaela Boyle.
Gormaith Ogat, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak in this very important motion on legacy inquests, and I want to also thank my party colleagues for bringing the motion to the House today. Over the course of yesterday's debate and thus far today, a lot has been said about the past. However, for many, many families, they have waited and waited, and many of those families are now no longer with us, and we remember them here today. Families now have heard from the Lord Chief Justice Declan Morgan on the future of legacy inquests and how they will be dealt with through the vision of a five-year plan, in the hope that they may now get truth and justice that they rightfully deserve. Last Friday, within my own constituency, I met and spoke with some of the families, with the families of Tobias Molloy and Eamon McDivitt. They have welcomed the Lord Chief Justice's five-year plan and the review led by Judge Reg Weir. The families conveyed to me that after almost four decades, they now believe that they feel more confident and have confidence with the justice and the inquest system. However, it did come with a caution. They are concerned about the resources in relation to legacy inquests. It is the understanding that unless the resource issue is resolved, only two further legacy cases can be conducted. The Lord Chief Justice's approach to this issue and his extensive engagement with the families has helped to restore a level of confidence in the criminal justice system. The Lord Chief Justice and his staff has to be commended for that. The opportunity may be undermined if the provision of adequate resources are not forthcoming. Indeed, it could cause significant damage to public confidence in the rule of law in general. We know there are around 54 legacy cases relating to deaths of 97 people from different backgrounds, which could be completed within 5 years if the PSNI, the British MOD, were fully cooperative with the Coroner's Service and the funding was provided. The British Government must immediately release the £50 million in funding for legacy inquests that has been requested by the Lord Chief Justice. And if the British Government are serious about dealing with the past, then they need to commit to an immediate and intensive negotiation on dealing with the legacy of the past, as my own party colleague Declan Kearney stated earlier. The British Government has an international obligation to undertake timely and effective investigations compliant with Article 2. It cannot delegate its responsibility to this Assembly. The Irish Government cannot be let off the hook here either. Their silence on this issue is deafening. And as co-guarantors of the Good Friday Agreement and subsequent agreements, they need to step up to the plate to challenge the British Government over its continual failures to live up to its commitments on dealing with the past. There has been long-running frustrations and a deep sense of anger felt by all of the families to deliver prompt and effective inquest proceedings. Families like the Ballymurphy families, who have been waiting 45 years on an Article 2 compliant inquest into the death of their loved ones. Their walkout of the meeting with the Secretary of State, Brokenshire, on the 19th of September does reflect the frustration felt by all of the families on the continued refusal by the British Government to honour their state obligation to deliver on this issue. The Lord Chief Justice's five-year plan demonstrates to families that they may now be in the cusp of getting nearer to the truth and justice for their loved ones, and they must not be failed. Sinn Féin does believe in justice for all. Gormayoga.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Principal Deputy Speaker, we've now had three motions here in just 2 days that have all touched on aspects of dealing with our past. And this has been an issue that has been talked about and talked about for many years in this chamber. And I'm sure there's an amount of public frustration with how much talking there's been and how little action. We await to see if the Secretary of State comes forward with a public consultation, and there will be much interest to see what form, if any, this takes and whether it leads to any progress on these issues. On legacy issues, we in the Ulster Unionist Party have long argued that they should be included within the package of measures for dealing with the past that have been discussed during the three talks processes of recent years. We saw no reason why, if a historical investigations unit, an independent commission for information retrieval, were to be formed as part of a comprehensive way of dealing with the truth and justice aspects of our past, that legacy coroner's courts could sit as part of that. There should be no hierarchy of victims. There should also be no hierarchy of investigations. And it would be concerning that even if a comprehensive package of bodies were to be agreed, that some people would have an extra option for investigation that others would not have access to. If the aim is to find an all-encompassing way to deal with our past that allows equal opportunity for those seeking truth or justice, to keep legacy inquests outside of this tent seems to contradict the motivation. And we would want to know more as to why anyone would be so opposed to this. And surely that would signal a lack of confidence in the proposed HIU. Principal Deputy Speaker, we must bear in mind that those who have been left with no option of review since the historical inquiries team closed its doors, those people who were patiently waiting for the HET to work their way through their caseload, getting ever closer to a review for their loved one until that hope was removed. Those people have been left in limbo. They're aging, fearful that they may never find out the truth about what happened to their loved ones and why, and may never have a chance at finally seeing justice done. So the present situation is clearly unsatisfactory and imperfect, and there are issues to be addressed. And I want to highlight some of the imperfections of the present situation. The House will know that I've long been involved in the campaign for truth and justice for the King's Mills families, devastated after the massacre by the IRA of 10 innocent Protestant workers in January 1976. And I again pay tribute to those families and the sole survivor, Alan Black, and the groups and the individuals who have supported the campaign and their persistence and dogged determination to pursue justice. But after a prolonged public campaign and battle, we eventually succeeded in having a fresh coroner's inquest convened, and this has now been hearing over the past few months. However, just 1 week into the fresh inquest, it had to be stalled because of new evidence relating to the existence of a palm print, which led to the reopening of the criminal investigation of King's Mills. On the face of it, this should have been a welcome development, except the existence of the palm print had long been known about, and we might have expected earlier progress in the criminal investigation than the 40 years since the horrific events of King's Mills. Understandably, the families and campaigners have been rightly concerned and cynical about the resulting delays, and public hearings of the inquest are currently on hold. Clearly, this is an unacceptable situation for the families, and it must be addressed as a matter of urgency. It is time for the truth about King's Mills to finally emerge, however difficult and however inconvenient. The wider point relevant to this debate is that the current system is clearly unsatisfactory, but any new system must be properly and fairly structured, and we must avoid at all costs any attempt to rewrite history.
Thank you very much, Madam Deputy, Principal Deputy Speaker. But before I come in here today, I was approached out in the Great Hall by a couple of men who I should have recognised, but to my shame I didn't, because they were two representatives of the McGurk Bar families. And an atrocity had also happened in 1971. I imagine they're in the gallery here, and it's good to see them again. They gave me quite a detailed account of their position on, in terms of the lack of progress and that particular incident. I said I would read it. I'm going to raise it here again. As I went upstairs, I was shown a copy of the Irish News, and there's an article in it that says that the army file on McGurk's Bar will not now be released until 2056. Now, for those of you who doubt your arithmetic, that's 85 years after the event took place. 85 years on, there won't be anybody left with any recollection of what happened. Now, what does that say to me? And I try to keep an open mind on these things. I think there's always two sides. Sometimes what appears obvious isn't actually what happened, and vice versa. But what that says to me is that the authorities and the army have something to hide. 85 years. Why would you want to bury something for that length of time? Other people have mentioned the Ballymurphy families. It's well known I've been supportive of them for quite a few years now. I will pay tribute to Doug Beattie. He's actually the second Ulster unionist who came to see them, but Danny Kilkenny only lasted 10 minutes. Doug came for a whole session, and a particularly revealing session it was too, because we went to see the Secretary of State, not for the first time, actually the first time with this Secretary of State. He listened, he talked, he said he could do nothing. Once again, he said it with a bit more grace than his predecessor, I would say that. But frankly, a major disappointment, another setback to a group of families who, again, are waiting 45 years. Some of the people I have dealt with since my involvement with Ballymurphy began are now dead. The contemporaries of the people who were killed are of an age. They won't last much longer. They are entitled to their day in the sun. They are entitled to justice, to the truth of what happened. And for the life of me, I do wonder, in the case of Ballymurphy, I've said it before, what on earth is there for the state to protect? In fact, there's nothing. There's nothing. What happened to Ballymurphy is self-evident. It's self-evident from the evidence that's on army files, never mind any other files, but there's plenty of evidence there. An inquest that could go ahead quite reasonably. And I'm sure there are others. Now, the Lord Chief Justice has weighed into this discussion in a very helpful way, and I'm sure he must be feeling quite disappointed at the turn of events and the fact that, frankly, the DUP are blocking this process once again. But the motion refers to the European Human Rights Act. It does actually say that apart from establishing the right to life and the state's obligations, it requires an effective and proper investigation into all deaths caused by the state, as well as imposing an obligation to protect life. Now, what is the state? I'm not a lawyer, but in this situation, what is the state? To my mind, in European terms, the state must be the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. So, is it reasonable for the British government to hide behind DUP intransigence, or should they be trying to do something about this off their own bat and bypassing the DUP? Because that is actually what's needed here. You might have thought we were getting somewhere with the Stormont House Agreement, which set up the Oral History Archive, the Historical Investigations Unit, the retrieval thing, and the Implementation and Reconciliation Body. But, you know, a year later, fresh start, sort of watered all that down. Well, what we're doing here is passing the parcel. it seems to be anything but make progress. And the people out there who put us
here must be
really wondering what is going on here. I plead with everybody involved to try and move this process forward as quickly as possible.
Here, Mr. Colin McGrath. I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. You know, I don't know if many people out there take the trouble to read Hansard, sort of in the daily proceedings. I used to do it, but then I'm a sort of political nerd, you know, sort of. I usually wouldn't admit that to anybody. You know, it's even worse than watching Stormont Today. You know, but if they did, sort of, and read over yesterday's proceedings, and then sort of sat down tomorrow morning and read today's proceedings, I think the first thing they would think is that it's all the one debate. It's all the same thing, because it's all about the past and overlaps and interpenetrates, sort of, in all these discussions about legacy and inquests and who's telling the truth and so forth, which nobody is really who was involved in these matters. So you know, I agree in one way with everything that's been said by everybody, because there's, you know, everybody's saying, you know, there should be no hierarchy of victims. So everybody agrees with that. You know, sort of, well, if we all agree sort of on those things, what's the problem? Where's the difficulty if we move forward? And the difficulty is political. It's political. And the fact of the matter is, we've had a motion from Sinn Féin which does not even acknowledge that its partner in government, sort of the DUP, are the people mainly who are holding this thing up, who are responsible for deadlock. It's not even mentioned. Now, there's one thing to have co-op moving on from the past and all that, and so we're all going to be nice to one another now, and we're all sort of cooperating sort of on the executive. Well, when that means that there's no movement for people who desperately need the truth to be told outside, then you have to question whether all this is worthwhile. You see, and if you look over, I don't think that I agree with the Lord Chief Justice. We've already said it's terrific. Who could disagree with sort of on humanitarian grounds or on philosophical grounds with what the Lord Chief Justice said and his proposals? Everybody would agree with it. I don't think it's going to work. It's not going to work for the same reasons that we all spelt out yesterday, or some of us did. All of it depends, if it's going to be successful, on the truth being told. And if the British government and others had any willingness to tell the truth, they'd have told it already. And in fact, you talk about all this money that's going to be involved. Sure, if they told the truth from the outset, there would be no need for any money to be spent. The only reason these things take time, and that lawyers earn, sort of, fantastical sums of money, is that nobody is coming clean. So I said, and we've had inquests. Remember this: some of the things that we're talking about now, the cases, there's already been inquests. I spent sort of a couple of weeks back, I sat down, and connected me something that I was writing, and read over again sort of the inquest papers into the deaths of Mr. Robert Johnson and Robert McKinney in 1972. And if you look at those deaths, there's something interesting emerges. I imagine there might be people here who don't know who Robert McKinney and Robert Johnson are. Think about it if you don't, because I'm about to tell you who they are. They were murdered by the Parachute Regiment, by the 1st Battalion of the Parachute Regiment, in 1972. They were murdered in the first week of September, 1972, on the Shankill Road. Mr. Robert Johnson was a well-known character around the Shankill. Just before he died, before the bullet hit him, fired by him. I could name the part. I won't, don't worry. But I could name him. Fired him, blew his brains out. His man, he was walking around, the last thing he shouted was, "I walked these streets in my bare feet in the 30s. A well-known character. He had come out of the wee house, sort of in Manor Street, out of the pub. The other man, sort of Mr. McKinney, was back after 30 years in Canada. His first day back in Belfast. Went out around the area where there had been rioting earlier, and is shot dead by the two people who fired those shots had also been involved in Glenfarra Park and the Bogside on Bloody Sunday. I know their names, I know exactly what they did. Why are they forgotten? I'll tell you one of the reasons they were forgotten. That the people who should have represented them, the people who should have been standing up for the interests and the lives of working class Protestant people in Belfast, didn't want to go against the state, and they said it, they've said it to me. We couldn't do that, Eamon. But if they had done it, we would have been seen to be supporting the likes of you, as he put it, sort of in Derry, in relation to Bloody Sunday. There's a political conundrum and a political contradiction which should be kept in mind when you're examining some of these cases. What I say finally is this. My advice to relatives is, yes, push it all the way, and I'll be with you. There was McGurk's Bar. For example, Kingsmills, Danny. I'll tell you what. If you're right, you tell the relatives, you're in touch with them, you know them personally. If they want to come out and march with the rest of us on Bloody Sunday weekend in Derry, they will be made extremely welcome in Derry. I say the same, the people there from the Birmingham victims, and people started from McGurk's Bar, people from Ballymurphy and all the rest of it. Victims should stand together. It's not just a question of us standing together. If they stand together, the only way we ever get anything in this country is by going out and organising and fighting for it. The victims should join together, and they will find a big welcome, an enthusiastic welcome for people who conventionally would be regarded as being on, so to speak, the other side. Let's do it together.
I call Jim Allister.
Deputy Speaker, it's indisputable that all are entitled to the truth, just as they are entitled to justice. But it doesn't end there, because the process that delivers that has to be a fair and an equitable process. And in this debate, we've heard some of the one-sided exposition of demands for legacy inquests. I'm not disputing the need for legacy inquests, though I'm not impressed that some of those demanding the loudest are those associated with an organisation which just didn't deny justice to their victims, but denied the most fundamental right of all, the right to life. And I do recognise, and I speak of Sinn Féin, that in making their demand, they see, of course, within this, a stratagem for state bashing. They see within it an opportunity to validate their determined rewriting of history. Hence the enthusiasm for the legacy inquest system, so that it can be abused in that sense, and the information garnered put to the ends of state bashing that they wish to advance. But the same people have nothing to tell us, and there are people on these benches in this House, and I'm looking at some of them now, who could tell us a great deal about the innocent victims they removed from this scene of time, but choose to keep those dark secrets in their hearts. And yet are those on the highest of horses demanding justice for those they present as the victims of the state. Let me be very clear. I do not put on a par the 8 IRA murdering men who went out to visit devastation and death in Lough Gall, with innocent shoppers going about their business on the Shankill Road or anywhere else, or innocent people sitting in a bar in Greysteel, done to death by hideous terrorists. No comparison. And yet the hierarchy that's being created is that for those who put themselves in the front line of terrorist activity, there must be legacy inquests. But for those whom they butchered and their colleagues butchered, nothing. And that is the hierarchy that has crept into this. And therefore, the DUP is right to have vetoed the progress, if you want to call it that, on this matter, until the inequality is recognised. But they were wrong at Stormont Castle to embrace the beginning of that inequality, because at the Stormont Castle agreement of 2 years ago, They agreed $19 million a year to Legacy Inquest, $6.5 million a year to the HIU for the overhanging HET inquiries. There is a source of the inequality. And that was agreed by the party that now has woken up to block the progress, the inequitable progress, in respect of this matter. Pity they hadn't woken up at Stormont Castle when they were agreeing those figures. But better late than never. And so I'm very clear. Yes, it's right that individuals are entitled to the truth. But there can be no hierarchy. A hierarchy
we'd ask the member to bring his remarks to a close, please.
By engendering an opportunity for state bashing while ignoring the horrendous terror of the terrorists.
And I call the Minister for Justice, Clare Sutherland.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I thank members for bringing this motion to the Assembly, and I welcome the opportunity to debate this very important issue. My position is very clear. Families have waited far too long for legacy inquests into the deaths of their loved ones. If we are ever going to bring some measure of closure to bereaved families, we need to reach political agreement on this and other legacy matters now. I have not experienced the loss of a loved one in a way that these families have, but I have met with a number of family members who are husbands, daughters, brothers and sons, and I have seen the very real pain and suffering that they live with on a daily basis, and that they have told me of the stress and anguish brought about by this continued delay. What has struck me is the similarity of the stories that the families bring to me, regardless of their background or the circumstances surrounding the death of their loved one. They have all suffered unimaginable hurt and loss, and they acknowledge that no one's family is greater than anyone else's. We need to listen to the voice of victims' families and be guided by them. The management of these complex inquests is not easy, but the continuing delay is having an unacceptable impact, not only on the victim's family, but on our wider community and our justice system. It is simply not acceptable that for some families have had to wait 30 or 40 years to have their loved ones' deaths investigated. And for some, Mr Deputy Speaker, it has been too late. To make the progress that is so urgently needed, the legacy inquest process must be better focused, better equipped and better resourced to meet the needs of the bereaved families. The Lord Chief Justice of Northern Ireland was appointed as President of the Coroner's Courts on the 1st of November last year, with responsibility for providing leadership to the judicial officers who act as coroners. He immediately commissioned a review of the state of readiness of the outstanding legacy cases, and this was undertaken by Lord Justice Weir in January this year. On that basis, and following a series of meetings in Strasbourg, the Lord Chief Justice proposed a new model for progressing legacy inquests. He concluded that, with the support of a properly resourced legacy inquest unit in the Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunal Service and cooperation from the relevant justice bodies, including the PSNI and the MOD, it should be possible to complete the existing legacy inquest caseload within a period of 5 years. Having discussed the Lord Chief Justice proposals with him, I am confident that they provide the basis for transforming the way we manage legacy inquests in Northern Ireland. His proposals, which should ensure that all the outstanding legacy inquests are completed within 5 years, offer real and tangible hopes to victims' families and that their cases will finally be brought to a conclusion. Mr Speaker, we owe it to the victims and their families to make the Lord Chief Justice vision a reality. The Stormont House Agreement includes measures to address a number of issues relating to Northern Ireland's troubled past. It is the only mechanism we have to provide some resolution for victims, and I will do all that I can to progress it. Mr Deputy Speaker, the Stormont House Agreement proposals may not give families everything they want and will not bring back their loved ones, but I believe that it will go some way into giving them what they need. The Stormont House Agreement made proposals covering two areas that fall within my remit as Justice Minister, one of which was to improve the way legacy inquests are concluded and the other to establish a historical investigations unit. The UK Government subsequently held cross-party talks to consider how best to progress the existing commitments to address the complex issues relating to Northern Ireland's past. These talks resulted in the Fresh Start Agreement. Whilst the agreement paved the way to resolve a number of difficult issues, including an end to paramilitarism, it did not address how we deal with the legacy issues of our past. However, discussions are continuing between the Northern Ireland Executive and the United Kingdom Government to resolve these outstanding issues, and I remain confident that agreement will be reached on establishing the new institution proposed in the Stormont House Agreement and on improving legacy inquest arrangements. Funding forms an important part of those discussions, including access to funds for progressing the LCJ's proposals. Mr Deputy Speaker, the justice system was never funded to address legacy issues. This funding gap has exacerbated the situation and undermined our capacity to address this complex problem. I am working with executive colleagues to resolve these outstanding issues and to secure the funding needed to allow legacy inquests to proceed in line with the proposals by the Lord Chief Justice. I have asked my department to review the funding requirements of the Lord Chief Justice proposals for legacy inquests, and this work is ongoing. However, it is important to recognise that any funding bid under the Stormont House Agreement will have to be agreed by the Northern Ireland Executive before being submitted to Her Majesty's Government as part of the overall funding package for dealing with the past. Since the Lord Chief Justice's appointment, a review of the available resources has been undertaken, and the Lord Chief Justice has made a number of significant improvements in advance of agreement on his wider proposals. In February this year, a High Court judge was appointed as presiding coroner to oversee the management of cases and consider issues relating to scope and disclosure. The presiding coroner, in conjunction with the Lord Chief Justice, determines which cases will be listed for hearing and when. A new coroner was also sworn in February, and a further coroner was appointed in April, bringing the coroner's service back up to its full judicial complement. The Lord Chief Justice has assigned a county court judge to deal with some of the more complex inquests. New counsel were appointed to the panel of counsel in November last year to provide advice to the coroner and to prevent evidence and inquests. And in March this year, a coroner's investigator was appointed to provide advice and guidance on appropriate and effective investigative opportunities and practice and procedures in relation to inquests as required by the coroners. She also conducts investigative opportunities with the relevant legal officer. In addition to these improvements, the Criminal Justice Inspection Northern Ireland was commissioned to undertake an inspection of the arrangements in place within the PSNI to manage and disclose information in support of the coronial process in Northern Ireland, and the report is expected to be published in the near future. Mr Deputy Speaker, members will also recall that the Northern Ireland Courts and Tribunals Service undertook a review of the overall operations of the Coroner's Service with a view to ensuring resilience within the service and to contribute to the development and implementation of arrangements for the processing of legacy inquests within the context of the Stormont House Agreement. 10 of the 13 recommendations arising from that review have been fully implemented and are already bearing fruit. Improved listing arrangements, for example, have helped to clear the backlog and ensure that more timely progression of inquests with fewer adjournments. Progressing the Lord Chief Justice proposals to streamline and reform the legacy inquest system is essential. However, progress in dealing with the past, including the Lord Chief Justice proposed enhancement of the legacy inquest process, can only be made following agreement on the implementation of the Stormont House Agreement and the release of the associated funding that it provides. Resolving the legacy inquest blockage is the only one part of the necessary solution to dealing with the past. I am confident that the new Historical Investigations Unit, when established under the agreement, will make a real difference in progressing future cases and will ease the burden on coroners in conducting the often complex investigations that have fallen by default to legacy inquests in the past. Turning to the First Amendment, I am... Sure, okay.
For giving way, she's expressed confidence in the establishment of improved legacy inquest arrangements and the historical inquiries unit. Does she have any idea of timescales to try and reassure victims as to when she thinks they will be put in place?
I thank the member for his intervention. Truthfully, I don't have a specific timescale in how we are going to progress legacy inquests. I have said in this House in previous occasions that I would be keen that it would happen sooner rather than later, and unfortunately that's the answer I can give now. But you know, I will assure the member and indeed other members of this House that it is something that I am progressing with my executive colleagues and the Northern Ireland Office to see how we can move forward on this, both on a historical investigation unit and legacy inquests. Together. Turning to the amendment, Mr Deputy Speaker, I am somewhat unclear from the amendment as to whether or not it is actually supporting the Lord Chief Justice's proposals. As our most senior judge, it is important that we listen when he makes proposals on such an important issue and act on his carefully considered recommendations. I am certainly not in fear of any hierarchy of investigations. I believe that all families should have access to a review or investigation of their loved one's death. and that's why I support the full implementation of the Stormont House Agreement, because I believe only through its implementation will the outstanding investigations be completed in a professional, impartial and timely manner.
Just in relation to some comments that were just made in the House, can the Minister confirm, and especially within the context of no hierarchy of victims, that there is no profile that has been agreed or had been agreed over the last number of years in terms of the financial arrangements between Inquest and the HIU, and that does need to be worked out very much on the basis of everything moving forward together?
I thank the member for her intervention. Certainly I can speak for my time as Justice Minister, and certainly I'm not aware of any particular relation to hierarchy investigations. I suppose I'm merely referring to what the motion has alluded to. Certainly.
Would the Minister care to look at the schedule in what became known as the Stormont Castle Agreement, the one which had to be squeezed out of the executive parties, but which sets out the tabular form the amount of funds for legacy inquests, $19 million, the new historical investigation unit for overhanging HET cases, $6.5 million, and $5 million for police ombudsman cases. It's there in black and white.
Thank the member for his intervention. I think what he's alluding to is the necessity around the funding of this of the legacy addressing the past. Indeed, I agree that we do need to properly resource all the mechanisms that we're taking forward in dealing with addressing our past. But indeed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's something that myself, along with my executive colleagues and the Northern Ireland Office, are working toward progressing. One more time, sure.
I do thank the Minister, and I do appreciate the change in approach to taking interventions today compared with yesterday. But could you confirm to the Assembly that when it comes to the release of monies for legacy inquests, which the Lord Chief Justice said he needed as a matter of urgency, his words, where is the impediment at an executive level? And if there is an impediment that you have no time frame for resolution, have you told the Secretary of State that it is your view, individually, that he should get on and fund now?
I thank the member for his intervention. I've made it quite clear to the Secretary of State that I do believe that legacy inquests is a way of progressing this within a 5-year time frame. And certainly I've made my feelings quite clear about the fact that we need to fully resource this. I don't have that resource within my own department, so it either has to come from a wider Northern Ireland executive resource or outside of that, whether that's the Northern Ireland office. I can only speak for my time as Justice Minister, and I know the previous Justice Minister has alluded to what he felt that impediment was. I think 5 months into this executive, we are at a stage where we're looking at this again, and I think we have to appreciate that we do have another Secretary of State in position, and he will look at how he wants to move this progressing forward. But I think it's a matter of process at this stage. Unfortunately, I can't give you a time frame. I would like to have been in a position to do so, but what I will say is that I will give assurance to this House that I am confident I will move forward. I know I've said this before, but in respect of how we deal with addressing with the past, Stormont House Agreement is what was agreed. Fresh Start is what was agreed, and I think we need to use both those mechanisms so that we can finally move on. Coming to Amendment 2, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I do agree that we need to support the Lord Chief Justice proposal as a matter of urgency, as has already been alluded, and I've been clear on that from the outset, particularly with a number of meetings that I've had with the Lord Chief Justice. I know from my own engagement with the executive colleagues and the Secretary of State that there is a strong desire to resolve the outstanding issues and move ahead with the implementation of the Stormont House Agreement, as just said. In conclusion, it is important that when considering legacy matters, we keep the needs of the victims' families at the heart of our thinking. The continued impact of our current arrangements on victims' families and our wider community is unacceptable. Mr. Deputy Speaker, our justice system is neither designed nor funded to deal with the legacy of our past, and we must act now to implement and obtain adequate funding for Stormont House Agreement institutions for dealing with the past, including improving our legacy inquest arrangements. And we must act now to resolve the issues of our past and finally bring some measure of closure to those who lost loved ones as a consequence of that past. And I am working with executive colleagues to make progress on the establishment of the HIU and obtain the release of funds to progress the Lord Chief Justice proposes in relation to legacy inquests. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I do support the motion, and I will continue to work with executive colleagues and members of this Assembly to resolve this issue in an urgent and timely manner for the benefit of everyone in Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Here, Sir Colin McGrath on Cleach Corley Lasu Everidaw. I call Colin McGrath to wane on amendment number 2.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And Mr. Deputy Speaker, the start and the end of this debate is the victims and their families. We must remember their pain, we must remember their suffering, and importantly, we must remember their future, which we have within our control to either help or to hinder. We have highlighted where we believe the problem lies in this matter. The DUP are refusing to allow a request for the funding for the inquests, and that is a terrible failure to those families. And I also want to reiterate the point that the Secretary of State needs to recognise that he has the ability to unlock this scenario and deliver the funding that is required to address the concerns that families and victims have. He must not allow the DUP to have a veto on the matter of legacy and inquests. To do so sets a dangerous precedent and sets us back in this process rather than enabling us to move forward. Now, some of the contributors have suggested here today that no family's suffering is more painful than another's. But by willfully blocking any resolution to any of these problems, we are failing and letting down all families, and that is unacceptable. We heard from Trevor Lunn about how there was some hope from the Stormont House Agreement, and we would also suggest that it goes back that there was hope as well in Eames Bradley's and other initiatives. But the problem is we continue to be let down, and that is unacceptable. I would like to commend Mr McCann on his contribution, which was a powerful contribution. It highlighted to us the importance that the truth will be able to be heard and will help all of us to be able to move forward. And he also made a powerful contribution that all families and victims should work together, because a collective voice working as one will help us to be able to unlock the funding which will deliver results and a resolution to these matters. I welcome the Minister's admission that families have waited too long to get a resolution to their suffering, and I also welcome her determination to do all that she can to pursue the matter. But I would say to the Minister, you're not going to get a resolution from this executive, so it may be a bit of a waste of time looking for that. You should be making your way to the Secretary of State and directly advocate for that money to be made available to the families of victims in Northern Ireland to help them get the truth that they require. It is difficult for families of the Troubles and the victims to move on without adequate and appropriate closure for the atrocities that their families endured. We need to see justice prevail, we need accountability, and we need acknowledgement. And in short, for that, we must have the legacy inquests. It's time we took narrow and vested interests out of this and work again to try and get a resolution for the victims and their families. In my constituency of South Down, we had many incidents and tragedies over the years. The people of Loch and Island suffered significantly when 6 local men were murdered in 1994. To compound the misery and suffering that the families of these individuals had to endure, recent revelations of collusion, destruction of evidence, and willful interference have compounded the pain that they must face. Mr. Deputy Speaker, there must be closure. There must be conclusion to the outstanding issues, and there must be an apology for the wrong that has taken place. Inquests will allow this process to begin for dozens of families. The victims seek this, their families seek it, and we must comprehensively and ethically address the past now. I believe that our amendment details the best way to achieve this, and commend the amendment to the House.
I call Roy Biggs to wane on amendment number 1.
I rise in support of the amendment in the name of my colleague Doug Biddy and others to support it. And in starting, I'm conscious that I'm thinking of the many victims that occurred in Northern Ireland as a result of terrorism over the many years. 3,500 people murdered, many maimed. and the difficulties that cause for their families. Many have spoken of the legacy inquest, but I think it's important that we also remember that there are many that have yet to had their case even reviewed since the end of the historical inquiries unit and their activity. I'm also conscious that many, many victims suffered loss, their families suffered loss, and no one was ever brought before the courts. They have suffered loss quietly. The families have had to get on with life. So there are many, many victims, and it's important that going forward that we do not create a hierarchy of victims. And that's the reason behind the motion, the amendment to the motion in the name of Doug Beattie and my colleagues. And going forward, we need a widespread agreement, a way that can gain support from everyone and take all victims forward. Now, Doug Beattie touched up briefly on the issue of what if information that might be released led to deaths, and this is something that is not hypothetical. This is something that has happened in Northern Ireland, and he is right to say that there are occasions when information should not be disclosed. He's also right to say if it's just about saving somebody's blushes, that's not due reason and it should be disclosed. He indicated he was present when the Secretary of State indicated that if the executive collectively called for the release of money, he would give it to them. So what he wants and what we want is fairness for everyone. And if we can get that agreement, there is the potential of moving this forward for the benefit of all victims. And that's certainly what Ulster Unions would want. And the power is with our executive in that. Reach agreement. Think of others as you argue your separate corner. And there is the potential for moving forward. Doug also highlighted the danger of the 5-year plan. The lack of detail, the costs. Now, legal cases are renowned for exceeding their time and their costs. And what is important going forward for justice in Northern Ireland is that other forms of justice do not suffer because of what we might commence. So it's important that there is a detailed plan and a deliverable plan that deals with all aspects of justice. Declan Kearney, and this was highlighted by a number of speakers, strangely directed all this far at the British government, as obviously this is this non-aggression pact in action again, and he failed to recognise that the Secretary of State has said if the executive agrees, he'll give the money. So if the executive can't agree, why is he not saying that the difficulties with the executive and ensuring that there's resolution there? And he urged that the legacy inquest be treated as a freestanding issue. But there's a real danger that we could end up with creating a process which focuses on a relatively small number of deaths in the troubled. Tragic as each of them are for each of the families, let's remember that 10% of troubles-related deaths were a result of state forces. And there's almost an implication that some are trying to minimise the impact of the 90% of deaths that were caused by Republican and Loyalist terrorist group. So it's important that there is justice for all those other 90% and for those who suffered as a result of terrorism, that there is a process for them to seek justice as they would wish. And this was highlighted in particular by Jim Allister and Paul Frew. My colleague Danny Kennedy highlighted the issue of Kingsmill's families. And again, this issue of this palm print, which was known about and wasn't progressed, and concern that the undue delays. Many valid points have been made, but why can we not listen to what has been said? Why can we not agree a way forward, an agreed way forward that will meet the needs of all families rather than focus on a small number of families? I urge you to support our amendment.
Nish Irim, Sir Gerry Kelly, Ahon Conclu, Giano, Lisham, Freya Waller. Now call on Gerry Kelly to conclude on the substantive motion.
Good morning, Lars Kankolia. And I've been taking copious notes, which is always a mistake. But I'll try. I won't be able to do it. And people have repeated other people in this. I may agree with Ian McConnell, at least in this, that over the last 2 days, this has been the same debate.
and all the issues that we've been talking about have been through those same days. I think the most important place to start is probably, a number of people have said similar things, but the Minister of Justice said, no loss is greater than another. And I absolutely agree with her. The difficulty in this debate as we went through it and listened to people was that while many people said similar things, once they then elaborated, and I point especially to Jim Allister, who has a clear hierarchy of victims, because he went out of his way to actually condemn people who were killed. So then the truth of the statement gets shown in its naked form. What I'm going to try and do is, I mean, this because we have done three debates over 2 days, this was specifically about legacy inquests. And I know it's normal because they are all connected, we moved off that. But the motion was here to support action which has been taken, and over the last couple of days we've been talking about inaction. But here we have a Lord Chief Justice who took action, who came in as President of the Coroner's Court, was asked to do it in November 2015. By January 2016, he had instigated a review. It was Justice Weir, I think, who was involved in that. He met the Council of Europe. He met UN human rights bodies. By February 2016, he did what nobody else has done before him, certainly no Lord Chief Justice. He went and met the families who are suffering and who have suffered and are suffering over decades to find out what their view was. And then he said that I can sort out the legacy issues, these outstanding 56 cases, in the next 5 years, because I have the plan, and indeed I think the Justice Minister went through quite a section of that plan, in the next 5 years. So when Doug says, you know, I need to see it, I don't know why you need to see it. It was the Lord Chief Justice we give the job to. He's the one who has the expertise, and the court service have the expertise. What has been missing in the past, he has said he can rectify. And of course, a core of that, and it was spoken many times over the last 2 days, was about disclosure and the lack of disclosure, which is at the core of that, but also the issue of funding. And he called for money. He said he could complete in 5 years with £5 million per annum in terms of this. If he doesn't get the money, I think someone mentioned earlier on, then perhaps only 2 further cases will be done. As someone else pointed out, there's only 13 cases being done up to now. So there's the issue. There are people waiting, and as I pointed out earlier, this is a coronial system. For the first time, for many families who have tried again and again and again to get some activity, to get something for their loved ones, we now have, some of them after 45 years, an action which will actually do it. And what's the problem? The problem is we can't get the resources for it. So let me deal with why we put a motion in as we did, and we've had criticism from a number of people trying to avoid issues. So let me not avoid anything. See, here's the issue. This is legacy cases. The responsibility for legacy cases under international law is with the British government. They're the ones who have to comply with Article 2. They're the ones who have the duty and, in fact, have the power to ask any other institution, including this one, to make sure that they comply with Article 2 as well. So it is their responsibility. It happened on their watch. They're the people who have to pay the money. They're the people, in fact, if you look at the logic of it, who said there's $150 million there, which should be used for legacy issues, and then have refused to use it. Yes, it is, and this is where I disagree with the other two, with the two amendments, as they have pointed out themselves and shown really the contradictions. Before you put in the amendments, you knew that the executive wasn't going to clear money for this. So let me say, as Sinn Féin, if the issue was only money, then, and we had the power to give it, then it would be given. The problem is, as many people have pointed out, and this is why I disagree with the amendments and why we will vote against them, is because they were put in there simply as an attack on the executive, as opposed to, and of course the executive can't come to that conclusion, isn't coming to that conclusion, but we all knew that before. And then actually the SDLP, they acknowledge that and say, you know, so we're not getting it there, let's get it from the British government, because that's where it's supposed to come from as well. So they actually agree with what we said in our motion. So they should, I will.
Are you saying to the chamber, therefore, this afternoon that you have not had conversations, or the Deputy First Minister has not had conversations with the First Minister and the Minister of Justice about bringing forward a paper to the Executive in order to make that request to London? Is that what you're telling us? Because if that is what you're telling us, then there might be some validity in what you say. But it's the understanding of everybody that there have been conversations trying to get this on through the Executive, in the absence of which it should go through London.
First of all, I'm not on the Executive, and neither are you at this stage, so I don't know what is happening in the Executive. What I'm saying is very clearly, and you have said it yourself, I don't know why you're challenging this, since yourself, Eamon McCann, a number of other people have got up and said that the difficulty is that we're afraid to say that we can't get the money through the Executive. I'm saying it. We can't get the money through the Executive. But I am pointing out, as you pointed out yourself, that this is the responsibility of the British government. The British government have the money. There is £150 million there for the legacy issues, and they should release it. End of.
Will the member give way?
Why not?
Appreciate the member giving way. Yes, of course the British government has responsibilities for Article 2, but it's also clear, given that his party was party to the Fresh Start Agreement, so-called, and the Stormont House Agreement, that work was to be done by the Executive and then funded by the British government.
Minister of Justice come in, because I presume he remembers that he was on the Executive and that he could have had some influence in this, and yet he now comes, now he's off the Executive, trying to blame everybody else on it. Well, no, I won't give way again. I've already given way. So if we can move on somewhat. I wanted, there were two or three issues, and I'm going to run out of time. There are two or three issues here which were mentioned by a number of people. And one is the hierarchy of victims, which we've mentioned many times. Another term was used was the hierarchy of investigations, which was used mostly by the unionists. And I wanted to try and deal with some of that in this way. You know, I'm glad to see actually people are starting to use our terms around equality and balance and all that, because I believe in equality of victims. I believe in balance. I believe in all of that. Now, but when you talk about the hierarchy of victims, you need to know what you're talking about. For instance, and the hierarchy of investigations, there is something like, conservatively speaking, do you want to speak up, Chris, or do you want to listen? Okay, well then leave. Do the right thing.
Could we have remarks through the chair, please, and if we would have no interruptions from the floor while the Speaker has the floor.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The hierarchy of victims, let's deal with that. There is a conservative estimate that 25,000 people from the nationalist community went through jails. 25,000. That means 25,000 fails. It means if they were charged in one thing, multiply that by 10. So when you talk about information and the lack of information and all of that, how many of the state forces went through the courts? So if you want to talk about equality, if you want to talk about justice, if you want to talk about people's rights, then have a think about it in terms of that. Because there's a lot of catching up to do if we want to deal with equality in terms of that. In terms of equality of investigations, let me repeat again what I said earlier. This is the coronial system, but we're supposed to be working from the start. We're not talking about truth recovery process. We're not talking about, we're talking about something which existed and then was refused. And I know earlier on that our colleague was Trevor Lund was talking about what they're now saying about the McGurk's Bar information. You won't get it to 56. The one thing where I will disagree with and I'm quite surprised at Eamon McCann on this one, is that he talks as if it is impossible to get at the truth. Yet Bloody Sunday did it. Yet we are getting investigations going. We are being able to set up these institutions. So I think what he is doing is nearly saying to victims, you will never get what you want. Whereas I am saying, we can do this, we can get it, but it needs people like the British government
draws remarks to give
the resources needed, and also, frankly, to tell the truth.
Okay, members, before I put the question on amendment number one, I would remind members that if it is made, I will not put the question on amendment number two. The question is that amendment number one, standing in the names of Mr. Mike Nesbitt, Mr. Danny Kennedy and Mr. Doug Beattie, be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
Okay, members, clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order, members. Members, please resume your seats. Order. Members, please resume their seats. Okay. The question is that amendment number one, standing in the names of Mr. Mike Nesbitt, Mr. Danny Kennedy, and Mr. Doug Beattie, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Okay. Do we have tellers, please? Thank you. Order, members. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Steve Aiken and order, members, please. Tellers for the ayes are Steve Aiken and Danny Kennedy. Tellers for the noes are Declan Kearney and Pat Sheehan. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors, please. good going. Order. Order. Will members please resume their seats? Order, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 88 members voted, 15 members voted aye, 73 members voted no. Amendment 1 therefore falls.
The amendment is not made then, so we can unfasten the doors. Now, the question is that amendment number 2 standing in the names of Mr. Alex Atwood and Mr. Daniel McCrossan be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
No.
Okay, all right. I have been advised by the party whips that in accordance with Standing Order 27.1AB, that there is agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So I now call for tellers. Do we have tellers? Do we have tellers? Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Colin McGrath and Jerry Mullen. Tellers for the noes are Declan Kearney and Pat Sheehan. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Order. Members, resume their seats, please. Order. Right. Clerk, read the result, please.
Simple majority division result. 88 members voted, 20 members voted aye, 68 members voted no. Amendment 1 therefore falls.
The amendment has fallen. The question now is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. Okay. I have been advised by the party whips that in accordance with Standing Order 27.1AB, that there is agreement that we now dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So I now call for tellers. Do we have tellers? Order, members. Order. Right. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Declan Kearney and Pat Sheehan. Tellers for the noes are Adrian McQuillan and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Okay. Order. Members, please resume their seats. Order, please. Clerk, please read the result.
Simple majority division result. 88 members voted, 43 members voted aye, 45 members voted no. The motion therefore falls.